It's good to have you back. We've missed you. Let's join together in inviting God to be here this morning. Father, I thank you that you are a God that gives us reason to rejoice. We have come this morning to worship you. We have come this morning to bow our knee before the God who has given us our everything. We have come, Father, to encounter you in a fresh and a new way. So we invite you by your Spirit to come and to visit us quietly within our own selves and corporately as we worship together in song and in thought. We give this hour to you. Be honored and glorified in it. And Father, we join together in praying that prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And we're going to be putting on a video that is our creed, Apostles' Creed, in a different fashion. So I want you to listen, and if you know the song, sing along.
We believe. We believe. We believe. This morning, for our responsive reading, we're going to take a little different approach, and that is related to our mission statement. In Christ we live. We live through loving, through investing, through through venturing, and through embracing. And we're going to look at it this morning in the form of a cross. And so, responsively, as we talk through what you should have had in your bulletin or had picked up in the bulletin, the responsive reading, our mission statement, we believe, will be led by me as the leader first, and then you will follow with repeating the bolded or congregational part. And so we're going to build a cross. We're going to build a cross for each of our four parts of our mission statement. The vertical portion of our mission statement that we will see this morning is related to our gift for us from God. The horizontal part of our cross that you will be repeating is related to what God is doing through us to others. And so, in Christ, we live. We believe God loves us. We believe God invested in us. Therefore, we invest in each other. We believe God ventured out to create us. Therefore, we venture out into the world for others. We believe God embraces us. Therefore, we embrace each other. In Christ, we live. Amen.
You probably noticed a kind of a running theme for the last several weeks, and we're going to continue to run that same theme for a long time, and that is for us to remember who we are, why we are as a church. And we believe, as we put together this vision statement or this mission statement of the church, it is a clear pronouncement of who we are in Christ. So I appreciate your taking the lead on that. We were doing some gathering this past week and at a meeting for visioning, and it was me and Kent that showed up, and as we were talking, we decided there's got to be a way that we need to keep reminding us what we're about and who we are. And this was his idea, and I get a feeling we're going to hear that Apostles' Creed again. I think it's a very good way to present it. But we're here this morning to worship, and worshiping doesn't go well unless we involve ourselves in worship. Someone invited us to open to our first song, Walk With Me, Faith We Sing, 2242.
Would you like to stand as we sing that?
Thank you.
John's going to come up and share a passage of Scripture this morning that continues on the theme that we've been looking at, our mission statement. This week we're talking about venturing. And this morning we're going to be talking about God venturing into our world.
Our first scripture lesson this morning comes from the book of John, chapter 1, reading verses 1 through 5. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. And the Word was God. He was God in the beginning. Through Him all things were made. Without Him nothing was made that has been made. In Him was life. And the life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Moving on to Genesis, the first chapter, 1 and 2. First this, God created the heavens and earth, all you see, and all you don't see. Earth was a soup of nothingness, a bottomless emptiness, an inky blackness. God's Spirit brooded like a bird above with a water abyss. Light, and the light appeared. Sky, in the middle of the water, separate water from water. God made sky. He separated the water under sky from the water above sky. Separate, water beneath heaven, gather into one place, land appear, and there it was. Earth, green up, grow all varieties of seed bearing plants. Lights, come out, shine in the heaven sky, separate day from night, mark seasons, days, and years. Lights in the heaven sky to give light to earth, and there it was. Swarm, ocean, with the fish and all sea life. Birds, flying through the sky over earth. Earth, generate life. Every sort and kind, cattle and reptiles and wild animals, all kinds. And there it was, wild animals of every kind. Let us human beings, in our image, make them reflecting our nature. God created human beings, He created them godlike. Reflecting God's nature, He created them male and female. God blessed them, prosper, reproduce, fill earth, take charge, be responsible for the fish in the sea and the birds in the air, for every living thing that moves on the face of the earth. God looked over everything He made. He was so good, so very good. Heaven and earth finished down to the last detail.
Great, the children to come forward to share the kids' story for the Genesis song. The Genesis song, right? Yeah, one up. Tiffany is doing her debut of kids'
sermons, and she's going to do a great job. Pardon? Oh, I'll give you this one. Her hands are. There you go.
We're going on an adventure. Do we have any more who would like to come and join us? I know we have some young, some people who feel young. They could come too. It's good to have you up here. And if you don't want to come up, that's okay. If you want to listen there, do you want to come up? That's okay. So what do you think of when you see this? Some people, when they think of camping and backpacking, might think that. Well, not everybody likes camping. I'm one who does. But when I think of the word venture, this is the word I think of. What does that say? I think of adventure. Adventure. And what I was going to talk about today is God is not boring. He is the author of adventure. Anyone who has gone to the mountains, have you been to the mountains? What do you think when you look down?
I've been to a national monument in Colorado, and when I looked down, it looked pretty darn beautiful.
I'd have to agree with that. And who made that pretty beautiful monument?
God.
Amazing. Amazing. When I think of adventure, God is so exciting and so amazing that He made all these wonderful things. And I'm going to show you some of the things in my backpack here for an adventure. What's going to happen in Minnesota in about a month? Snowing. For Minnesota, this is what you need. Okay. And I have some mittens here. This is Minnesota Adventures, right? The reason that I put a coat and a hat in my adventure bag is because in Minnesota, we cannot enjoy all the beautiful, wonderful things to do in Minnesota unless we're covered. Could you go skiing without a hat or mittens or gloves? What do you think would happen?
Frostbite.
In order to enjoy all that God made in Minnesota, we have to have a covering. We have to have a coat. And I'm going to tell you something a little bit about when God created all those things, the mountains and the deep oceans and all the adventurous things. He knew something was going to go wrong. And He still did it anyway, because He's so adventurous. There's something else I have in here that God needed for Adam and Eve, the very first people that He made. They needed a covering in order to enjoy Him. Do you know why?
Tree of knowledge. They didn't really wear anything, so I don't really think they needed to be covered.
Oh, they didn't they did need to be covered later. Do you remember why?
Because they ate the tree of knowledge and also they knew everything and then they're going to die.
Yes, God has certain things to keep us safe in this adventurous world. And Adam and Eve decided, I don't really trust that what you say is good and right. I'm going to decide for myself what's good and right. And then that broke the relationship they had with God. But God, even though He knew they were going to rebel and go against Him and stop trusting Him, He made a way to cover them so that they could enjoy Him once again. They believed the serpent instead of believing God, didn't they? Do you know what they covered him with? Well, this is kind of... this is really out of my son's survival pack. You feel that? What did that come from, do you think?
Cow leather.
I'm actually not... bear. It was a skin. Now, do you think this was alive at one time? This is real. This was what happened when sin, when people stopped trusting God and they decided, I'm going to decide what's good and right. I don't trust God to decide that for me. God said that would bring death. And so God, instead of having Adam and Eve die, an animal died. And he used that to cover Adam and Eve in the garden. Even though God knew that their relationship was going to be broken, he still was an adventurous God, and he still created all things beautiful.
Well, what he did do is he killed a sheep and sheared the skin off of two sheep.
You're right, and that's why there started to be sacrifices of sheep, because it was pointing to someone who is going to be the lamb that would cover us, that would cover our sin. Who is the Lamb of God who covers, takes away our sin?
Jesus.
Jesus. And did you know that God planned that before he created the earth? And it's in God's word. Do one of you guys want to read that? Do you feel comfortable reading in front? Okay, I'll do it. This is from God's Word in 1 Peter. It says, with the precious blood of Christ, because we need a covering, it says, he was chosen before the creation of the world. So when was God chosen to cover us? That's the Bible says.
Before everything?
Before everything was made, he chose Jesus before the creation of the world to cover us so that we could go on the greatest adventure ever. God, he is the greatest adventure. Let's pray. Lord God, you know all things. You know the past, the present, and the future. And you delight to have your children know you intimately. And Lord, there's so many times we choose our own way and we do not trust you. But thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you for sending your Son to be a covering for us, so that we can enjoy you forever. Amen.
Right, you turn your hymnals to hymn
number 77. We're going to sing together, How Great Thou Art. Let's stand together.
Thank you.
noticed as I was looking at the order of service that I had left the offering out. How sad is that? I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward to receive a morning tithes and offerings. We're going to continue with singing a song, but we're not going to sing quite as many verses as we usually do, but we're planning to do. Let's do verses 1 and 4. Verses 1 and 4 of 569. Verses 1 and... John?
We go back to the book of John. I'll be reading from John 3, 16 through 17, and then followed up by John chapter 6, verses 35 through 40. For God expressed his love for the world in this way. He gave his only Son, that's whoever believes in him, will not face everlasting destruction, but will have everlasting life. Here's the point. God didn't send his Son into the world to judge it. Instead, it is he here to rescue a world headed towards certain destruction. I am the bread that gives life. If you come to my table and eat, you will never go hungry. Believe in me, and you will never go thirsty. Here I am standing in front of you, and still you don't believe. All that my Father comes to me, comes to me. I will receive everyone. I will not send away anyone who comes to me. And here's the reason. I have come down from the heaven not to pursue my own agenda, but to do what he desires. I am here on behalf of the Father who sent me. He sent me to care for all. He has given me so that nothing and no one will perish. And in the end, on the last day, he wants everything to be resurrected into new life. So if you want to know the will of the Father, know this. Everyone who sees the Son and believes in him will live eternally. And on the last day, I am the one who will rescue him.
Thank you, John. Let's just take a moment and pray. Father, there are days that... You walk right into some thoughts you want to share, and you don't bother to come into your presence and say, God, we want you to speak this morning. So this morning, we invite you to be here. We invite you to share with us truth that we need to hear, truth that we can wrestle with and that we can authenticate in our own lives. So we give this time to you and ask that your word would become alive and real to us in a special way. In Christ's name, amen. You know, we've been talking about in Christ we live, and for the last several weeks we've been talking about the different letters. The first letter was love, and for 2 weeks we talked, one, about God's loving us, and two, we talked about our response from God's love is to love each other. The second one, the last 2 weeks, we've been looking at God's investing in us, and then in response to His investment in us, our investing in others, in the world around us. This morning we're beginning to talk about two weeks about God is venturing towards us. Now the reason why I think that's an important passage, and I love what you had to say, is that God ventured knowing that we would fail. I don't know why God ventured in creating man, but He did. He created us, and in fact the scripture tells us He created man in His own image. He intentionally created us knowing that we would intentionally turn away from Him. What does this say about God? I think it says something very significant about God. It says God chose to create because He wanted to be able to love that which He had created. God chose to create because He wanted to unconditionally love that which He had created. Why? I guess that's the love of God. God loves us. God created us. And what's even more interesting is that He created all the world. He created all that is. And then He created man. And in fact, in Genesis 2, it says, "And God formed man out of the dust of the earth and breathed life into him." And so, different than the passage that was read that said God spoke and things happen, a bit different. Instead of God speaking and things created, God formed man out of the dust of the earth and breathed life into him, which says to me that there was some reason that He wanted man to be created and why He would take a special interest. And then He goes on to say, "Now I want you to take my world that I've created, my creation that I've created, I want you to take charge, I want you to take care of it." And so man, Adam and Eve, lived in the garden, lived at peace and harmony with all that was. I don't know where the mosquitoes were at that time. I don't know where the cockroaches were at that time. But there was harmony, there was peace, there was joy, there was a perfect life. And God knew that when He created man, He knew that He couldn't dictate to him, because if He dictated to God, to man, then the man wouldn't love God because of God's love for them. And so He gave man the freedom to choose. And in spite of the fact that we chose wrongly, God pursued us and loved us. One of the things about the Old Testament, someone in here said to me, "You know, the Old Testament is irrelevant. The Old Testament has no value." But you know what? The Old Testament are page upon page upon page of God demonstrating His love for us, or His people. I know, you read the scriptures and you see that there's all sorts of things that seem to be violent. But you know what? God chose to love the Jewish people. God chose to use them as a vehicle for them to love the world. And yet, the Jewish people, like all of us, screwed up over and over and over again. But God continued to love them. God continued to demonstrate His care for them. God continued to care for them. And yet, they continued to mess up over and over and over again. And that's really a picture of God's unconditional love. God created us so that He might love us unconditionally. Knowing very good and well that man was going to mess up, He still created us, and He still gave us permission to rule over what He had created, and He still still invested in us. He still ventured out with the hope that we would move rightly. And, of course, seeing that we wouldn't, but he still did. The passage of scripture that John just read in John 3:16, all of us know that passage. It's one that we probably have memorized over the years, where God expressed his love for the world in this: he gave his only son so that whoever believes in him would not face everlasting destruction, but will have everlasting life. And most of us talk about that verse of scripture, and that's really a key verse of scripture that talks about God's love for us. But one of the things I was looking at today and looking at verse 17. Verse 17 is more important to me than verse 16. Because verse 17 tells me not only that God loves me, but he tells me that he came not to destroy. Let me read it. Here's the point. God didn't send his son into the world to judge it. Instead, he is here to rescue the world headed towards certain destruction. The purpose of God sending his son, which, by the way, as Tiffany said, was before the first sand was laid on the ground of this earth, before the first drop of water was put on this earth, God had already decided that he would send his son to die on the cross, because he knew that we would make a bad choice. But in the midst of that, he wanted to say over and over and over again, I love you. We see it all the way through the Old Testament. And even if we're really honest, we see it now. God pursues us with love. He never stops pursuing us. We may wander off and do our own thing, but he never stops pursuing us. But what's intriguing to me is that sometimes we see God as a God who's here to straighten up the mess. Jesus Christ came to clean up the mess and to judge the world. But this verse tells us he didn't come to judge the world. He came to introduce himself once again to us so that we could accept his love and escape judgment which we have brought upon ourselves. Sin was not God's idea. Sin was our idea. We were talking last night, and one of the things that I'm more and more convinced of is that we are all selfish people. Aren't we? We are all selfish people. How many people aren't selfish? How many people are selfish? Yeah, we're all selfish people. We do it very well. And in the midst of the fact that God knows we were selfish, in the midst of the fact that we live for ourselves, God still pursues us to love us. And the powerful part of the passage of Scripture in verse 17 is that even though he knew we were selfish, in fact, because he knew we were selfish, he came to free us from our own selfishness. He came to free us from our own selfishness. Now, we still have a choice. We don't have to accept that forgiveness. We don't have to choose to follow or to accept Christ. But he still did it. And everyone, God, the pastor says in John 6, God wanted everyone to come into an understanding of faith. God wanted everyone to escape the wrath of our own sinfulness. And yet, he came. He ventured forward to us. He came and he created the earth. He came and he created you and I. He came and he created with the purpose, the intent of giving us forgiveness through Jesus Christ. Now, I honestly have to say this. I don't deserve God's forgiveness. I just don't deserve it. And the reality is, none of us do. In fact, what's happened to me over the years is I used to look at people askew when they didn't things that were wrong, that I thought were wrong, and they shouldn't have done that. And sometimes we as a church become kind of critical of people who do things that don't fit our expectations or our designs. But you know what I've discovered? Honestly, there ain't no sin that's sitting in the pew this morning that makes you any worse a sinner than I am. We are all sinners. Paul said he was the chief among sinners. Paul said he was the least of the least, because he recognized it is only by the grace of God and his forgiveness that we have the release from the bondage of our own destruction. Christ came to free us from the bondage of our own destruction. I think it's important as we talk about who we are as a church. Do you know that I believe the statistics are 87% of the people who don't go to church, 80% of the people who don't go to church and look at the church say the church is filled with hypocrites? So I don't know which of you are 87%, but I'm sure I'm one of the ones that's not. We're all hypocrites. And the world sees that we're hypocrites. And the problem is that we don't see that we're hypocrites. We don't see our own sinfulness. And so we start talking about God venturing down and loving us unconditionally. It becomes that stepping stone for us to begin to love others, to venture into other people's lives and to say to them, God loves me unconditionally. Therefore, I desire God to love through me to you. We're going to talk more about that next week. But what would happen in our lives if we begin to see how much God has invested in us? What would happen if we would begin to understand how much God has ventured out for us? What would that change in how we treat each other? How would that impact the lives that we touch? How would that impact our marriage? How would that impact our relationship to our children? How would that impact our relationship to other churches around the area? Enough said. I invite you this morning to begin to ponder the greatness of God's adventure in creating you and to see how much love he has for you. Let's pray. Father, I believe that you have, Tiffany said, joined in the adventure of giving himself to us. Joined in the adventure of knowing very good and well that we would fail, but that he would come to give us pardon. Lord, I pray that this morning as we explore your investment in us, we might also explore the depth of love, the depth of care that you have for us to send your son to die that we might be forgiven. Bring us into a clear awareness of that, Father, in our own lives. In Christ's name.